Hey there, hope everyone's doing okay this week. In the last video, we talked about how phrases combine to create period structures and all the different types of period structures that are generally observed in the literature. Many of those we looked at were very clear-cut four-bar phrases. But as we know, music is creative and messy, and some periods aren't going to fit into that neat four and four mold. So today I want to talk about all the different ways that a period can be modified, and also what happens when phrases don't conform to a weak, strong, cadential pattern. Sometimes a period won't fit neatly into that 4x4 mold because it's been enlarged or extended somehow. When a period is enlarged or extended, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's just a longer period. That doesn't mean that if your typical period is, say, 8 bars, that doesn't mean that you're just going to have a 16-bar period and that's an enlarged or extended period. These are enlarged or extended in very specific ways. In this Beethoven example, we see that each phrase is 8 bars long for a total of 16 bars, giving us in this case, a modulating parallel period. Now, just because this one is 16 bars doesn't mean that it's been enlarged from a 8-bar period. This is not the type of enlarged we're talking about. There's specific ways that a period can be enlarged, and we're going to talk about those now. So when we talk about extending or enlarging a period, this is generally going to be done in three ways. So one of the most common ways that a period is enlarged is just to simply repeat one of the phrases, either the antecedent or the consequent phrase. In the case of repeating the antecedent phrase, we can look at this Beethoven example here. Let's have a listen to that. So if you notice here, we have in the first 4 bars the antecedent phrase, and then we have a half cadence there in bar four. Now, in the second antecedent phrase, the melodic material is varied slightly, it's just up an octave. But aside from that, there's really no changes. The second antecedent phrase ends in a half cadence there in bar eight. But in bar nine, we begin our consequent phrase, and we very clearly end here in a perfect authentic cadence. So we would still call this a period because we have a half cadence, perfect authentic cadence relationship. We still have a weak to strong relationship. It's just been repeated. Just as a note, be careful not to mistake a repeated antecedent for sentence structure. That's something very different. You can read about sentence structure in your Clendenning textbook on page 366. The repeated antecedent is far more common, but you will from time to time see a repeated consequent. I want to take a look at this example here from yet again Beethoven. We'll be seeing a lot of Beethoven today. Let's have a quick listen to this one. So this example starts as just a normal contrasting period. We have our antecedent in measure 91 with a half cadence in measure 94. In measure 95, our consequent phrase starts and ends there in measure 98. But in this particular period, Beethoven repeats the consequent phrase. The second consequent phrase ends there in measure 102 with a perfect authentic cadence. So we know that the antecedent or the consequent can be repeated in a period. But it can also be just simply extended if the composer chooses to add a little bit more material there. If we look at this example here, this is Mozart, K283. Let's listen to this. Okay, so here, the first four bars you should have heard ending in a imperfect authentic cadence. They're in measure four. In bar five, a new idea starts, this in the consequent phrase, and this is prolonged through these 16th notes in measure eight and nine to the perfect authentic cadence there in measure 10. So in this case, our antecedent phrase was four bars long, and our consequent phrase was just extended to be six bars. So we have four bars, six bars, but we still have the imperfect authentic cadence in bar four and a perfect authentic cadence in bar 10. So this would give us a contrasting period with an extended consequent. The antecedent phrase can be extended as well, but that's you're less likely to see that than an extended consequent phrase. Similarly to the string quartet example that we looked at a few moments ago, where the antecedent was just repeated once. You can also have just a number of antecedent phrases. Here's an example of a song by Thomas Ford. This example is in your Barry textbook. Let's listen to that.
Humphrey is coming to these bars. Here shelter is from sharpest showers. Cool gales of wind breathe in these shades. Danger none this place invades.
In this example, he's using a series of half cadences to sort of pause the music between each sentence of text here. And he does this three times before finally concluding on a perfect authentic cadence. Keep in mind that these different ways of extending or enlarging the period can be used together and in conjunction. So I'd like to look at yet another example from Beethoven. you might notice this from the assignment, but I didn't give you guys all of it. This is the entire example. So let's listen to that just to remind you what it sounds like. So there's a lot going on here, but there should be some identifiable parts to this. in the first four bars, it starts off like a typical period, and in this case, it was a contrasting period. So in the first four bars, we have our antecedent phrase ending in a half cadence, and the next four bars, we have our consequent phrase ending in a perfect authentic cadence. But if you notice, he uses the motivic material to repeat the consequent phrase here. It's slightly different, but it's very much like the first consequent phrase. Now, in measure 12, he still doesn't stop. He repeated the consequent phrase already, and now for measure 12, he's just extending it. So in this example, we have both a repetition of the consequent phrase, and then we have an extension of that phrase in measures 12 through 16. Before he ends in a very Beethoven-esque cadence, they're in measure 17. All of the examples that we've talked about so far have been periods of some sort. The Beethoven was a contrasting period with a repeated consequent and an extension. That's what you'd call it. But it was a period. The next thing I want to talk about is what's called a phrase group. Now, a phrase group is not a period. A phrase group is when you have at least two phrases that share melodic material but don't follow a typical weak, strong, cadential structure. A phrase group generally doesn't have the same closure that a period does. When you have a period that's weak and strong, you have a sense of a closure and balance. A phrase group, while it may share melodic material and motivic material, it doesn't share that same harmonic relationship. Phrase groups are more often seen in pre-classical music, but they're also seen in Romantic era music and modern music as well. It's also not uncommon to see them in transitions and developments. One way that might be helpful for differentiating a phrase group from a period might be to compare it to, say, poetry. If a period is a basic rhyme, a phrase group is going to be more like blank verse or like prose. You know, if I say, I do not like green eggs and ham, I do not like them, Sam I am, you know, that's going to be a period. You have a rhyme there. But on the other hand, if I say, I do not like green eggs and ham, nor do I fancy pineapple pizza, I consider it a crime against humanity. That would be more akin to a phrase group. Notice I didn't have any rhymes there. There wasn't like a strong sense of conclusion necessarily. It just kind of more spun out. So when we're looking at a phrase group in terms of what cadences you see in a phrase group, because you do see cadences in a phrase group, it's more common for a phrase group to have just a bunch of half cadences. But a phrase group can have a half cadence, a perfect authentic cadence, and then a half cadence, and that's still a phrase group because it doesn't follow that weak cadence, strong cadence relationship. You could also have a perfect authentic cadence, perfect authentic cadence, perfect authentic cadence, and that would still be a phrase group because, again, you don't have a weak cadence, strong cadence relationship. So there's no doubt that you've heard a phrase group before, but we're going to listen to one that maybe you haven't heard. This is in your Barry book. They give you the first violin and part of the second violin line. But we're going to look at the whole enchilada here. So it's a little bit longer of an example, so have a listen. So notice how different this is from our very basic period structures that are very nice and neat, right? This is kind of all over the place, but it's still a gorgeous piece of music. And this style really set the stage for music of the Romantic era. Notice that there's no real definable period structure. We have a lot of half cadences here, but no perfect authentic cadence, and notice that the end of the example just ends on a half cadence. So I think with this example, you can really hear that sort of to be or not to be, rather than green eggs and ham here. Now, the Beethoven is a beautiful example, but I want to look at a different example in a little bit more detail. So this is Mendelssohn, Opus 53, one of the songs without words. let's listen to that. Example, we have three phrases. In the first example, we have a half cadence in A minor. They're in measure 23. The next phrase starts in the pickup to measure 24. That phrase ends on a perfect authentic cadence in G major. So up until this point, we might be tempted to call this just a modulating parallel period. But there's an extra phrase here that returns to A minor and ends in A minor on a half cadence once again, with, you know, similar melodic material. Slightly different, but it's similar enough to call this phrase part of the previous two. And of course, right after this, we return to the main theme. So in this case, we have a half cadence, we have another phrase that ends in a perfect authentic cadence, and then we have another half cadence. So here, again, we don't have a weak cadence, strong cadence relationship. But the melodic material is similar enough to justify grouping these three phrases together. So the last thing I want to talk about today is how composers will join structural units, so like periods, phrases, and phrase groups, in a way that keeps the music from sounding broken and fragmented. If you have just a series of, you know, period structures, that's going to sound very fragmented. And so to keep the music from sounding so fragmented, composers will often overlap units together to maintain the momentum of the piece that you're listening to. And they do this through elision of two phrases, meaning one phrase will end at the same time that another begins. We'll look at an example of this here. This is Mozart, K280. Let's listen to this. All right, so here we have a period that elides with another period or phrase unit. The antecedent phrase here is 6 bars long. You can see there in measure 6, we end with a imperfect authentic cadence. In measure 7, the consequent phrase begins, has kind of a false ending there. In measure 10, which kind of restarts. And then in measure 12, as we approach our true cadence, we notice that the conclusion of that cadence, of that perfect authentic cadence, is the beginning of a totally new idea here. So as I'm sure you noticed, the music didn't sound like it just stopped. It was able to just maintain that momentum and keep going. Let's look at another example here. This is a Clementi Sonatina. You might recall this from your Clendenning theory textbook. Let's listen to this one. Here, Clementi starts very clearly with our motivic idea, repeats. Here we have a very clear 4-bar phrase ending there in measure 4 with a half cadence. There's our weak cadence. The motif restarts in measure 5, and it begins a modulation. So here we have a modulating parallel period, but what makes this one different is in measure 8, it begins a new phrase. So we have the ending of one phrase and the beginning of a new phrase overlapping. And so as you're analyzing these pieces, you know, be aware that this is possible, that it is possible for phrases to overlap. And don't let these kind of things throw you off, because you will see them from time to time.